Talk about a field of dreams. Well, now the field is his, and all of a sudden, the grass began to look a little greener. A season that was once looking forward to autumn now seemed to be yearning for the return of spring. Even the seats that were for years content with rehashing past glory were now told their best days still lie ahead.
I want to restore that nostalgia, that aura, that feeling, the presence of that this stadium gives you as you sit out here.
And with that, even the pole that's guarded center field seemed to wave its gentle approval. At long last, an organization begging for love had finally found someone who would love it.
You know, when you love something, you don't consider it work. And the hours that I would put in here wouldn't faze me 1 ounce.
And a fly ball to deep left center. It's well hit, and this one's gone.
And so it came to pass. It took until the dying days of August, but Mike Ilitch was finally allowed to step forward and deliver one of the biggest clutch hits this franchise has ever known. This was truly a glorious opening day. With it came the beginning of a new Tiger era. With it came the promise of an owner whose heart is dedicated to his boyhood team and all of its fans.
I'm going to work real hard on keeping this franchise proud. I dream of the day the buses are coming from all over the state and thinking nothing of it, and lots of counties and towns and areas where the dads and moms take the sons and the daughters to the game, maybe once a year, but it's a special outing.
Mike and Marion Ilitch officially became the seventh owners of the Detroit Tigers on August the 26th. And from that day forward, a feeling of excitement, enthusiasm, and good old-fashioned pride in the hometown baseball team captured the whole community.
And he hits it deep into right center field. Way back, this one's got a chance. It's gone. Into the bleachers in right center field. He hit this one.
It's a hit-you-in-the-face feeling that's impossible to miss. Sparky feels it. The players feel it. And more important than anyone else, so do the fans. Their beloved Tigers, once again, carry the magic they have for nearly a century. The Tigers rocked the American League in 1992. Fans feel it's only the promise of good things to come as Mike Ilitch begins to plant his Midas touch on the team so loved throughout the entire state of Michigan. On the field in 1992, Tiger bats provided most of the fireworks. They were dangerous. They were deadly. Enemy pitchers had to live on the edge. An offense like the Tigers could jump up and sting the enemy just when it thought it was safe. For the ninth time in history, the Tigers led the major leagues with 182 home runs. And for the 11th time in history, the Tigers led the majors with 791 runs scored. There was pop throughout the lineup, and most of the pop is back. A warning to all challengers, enemy beware.
Ah, I feel good. I knew that I wouldn't.
Leading the parade again, of course, was Detroit's gentle giant, Cecil Fielder. The big guy took on the Bombers from the American League. He took on the Bombers from the National League. And this time, he even took on the ghost of the game's most celebrated slugger. And he whipped them all.
So good, so good, I got to you.
And here's a long one. Oh, he's hit it a mile. Woo, up or down.
Driving in runs as easily as we drive home from work, Cecil finished with 124 runs batted in to lead the major leagues for the third straight season. The last and the only other man to turn that trick, none other than Babe Ruth himself. back in 1919, 1920, and 1921. No one summed up the Ruthian feat better than old Sparky when he said, "That's over 70 years, and ain't nobody done it, and ain't nobody gonna do it again." Cecil punished the ball. His attack was not only Ruthian, it was out and out ruthless. He became the first Tiger in history to belt at least 35 home runs and knock in at least 120 runs in three straight seasons. The Tigers produced their own version of 30-something in 1992. Club 30, in fact, attracted quite a crowd. Cecil led the way, of course, with 35 rocket shots. He was joined in the exclusive Club 30 by a pair of musclemen who did a lot of ripping and roaring of their own.
And a long drive. Is it going to be fair? It is. Home run for Tettleton.
Mickey Tettleton and Rob Deere each belted 32 homers. It's the first time in Tiger history that three players connected for at least 30 homers. From both sides of the plate, Mickey tattooed enemy pitchers. He turned a Ben McDonald serving into one of the longest home runs hit at Baltimore's new park.
And a long drive if it stays fair, and this one is way out of here. Whoa, did he unload on this one? Three in a row by the Tigers.
Three times he ended a game with a homer. Remember this laser shot against Boston in June to say goodbye in the 11th inning? A hand injury held Deere to only 110 games. Nothing, however, could contain his raw power, improving his batting average almost 70 points from 1991. Deere also boosted his home run total to 32.
Here's a long drive. This one is gone. A home run for Deere, a three-run homer, and the Tigers lead by five.
There's little doubt when Deere connects. The only question is where and when the ball will return to earth. Deere provided perhaps the season's most breathtaking blast at Tigers Stadium when he zapped a Ben McDonald offering onto the roof in left field.
You mean he's... Oh, Lord, look at here.
This is a mile high and deep and on the roof! Still on the roof! And comes back down.
The Tiger power arsenal was deadly, and it didn't stop with Club 30. Seven Tigers connected for at least 10 home runs. Four topped the 20 mark as enemy pitchers sweat. You make my heart sing. Tony Phillips connected for 10 round trippers. But Tony's real value is measured in many ways. Tony Phillips is a tempest in a teapot. He's the little man who refused to be bullied. Tony is the type that makes things happen. He's the kind of player who rolls up his sleeves, spits in the dirt, and then gets down and dirty. Don't sit on Tony, because he won't sit down on you. If you get into a fight, make sure this guy is on your side. Phillips crossed the plate 114 times to become the first Tiger since Ron LaFleur in 1978 to lead the major leagues in runs scored. Tony is a leadoff man supreme. He works on a pitcher's mind before slicing out a piece of the pitcher's arm, and he does it with surgical precision. Tony averaged more than a hit a game, and he also walked a career high 114 times. From the right side or the left, Tony is a pitcher's plague.
And here's a drive into left that's going to be caught by Phillips. Oh, what's going on here?
In the field, Tony is a jack of all trades. If you need him at second base, Tony is there. Need him at third base or shortstop? Tony is there. Need him anywhere in the outfield? Tony is there. Tony spent his off days serving as the designated hitter. He's a manager's dream. The only time Tony complains is when he's not in the lineup. In 1992, there were few complaints. Some of that spunk has rubbed off on the right people, and no one is more right than All-Star Travis Fryman. Travis is a quiet youngster, a gentleman in the truest sense of the word. Once he steps on that field, though, Travis turns into a terror. He plays hard. He plays to win. He expects everyone around him to sweat and bleed with him. Travis started the season at third base. When Alan Trammell went down with a broken ankle on May 15th, Travis switched to shortstop. He moved to third in the batting order, and the Tiger lineup never skipped a beat.
Here's a long fly ball to left, way back, and this one is gone. Over the screen, all the way out of the ballpark.
Fryman turned in his second straight 20-homer season. He set career highs with 96 RBIs and 87 runs scored. In the field, the youngster plays far beyond his years. To the right or to the left, Travis gobbles up would-be hits. Accurate and brutally strong, nobody cheats on Fryman's arm. Travis was rewarded in 1992 with his first All-Star selection. At just 23 years old, more All-Star games are sure to come. Personal honors are appreciated by Travis, but he's more concerned with winning than anything else. Don't ever loaf next to Travis. He'll let you know. Fryman is the leader of future Tiger stars. There's good news for Tiger fans. His star does not shine alone. One of the most promising young players to emerge from the Tiger Farms is pitcher John Doherty. The right-hander rose quickly through the Tiger ranks and made the leap after pitching Double-A at London. The ride was fast, but he made the team the old-fashioned way. He earned it. Doherty made his first mark in spring training. He shot down hitters like a marksman at a shooting gallery. After starting the season in the bullpen, the youngster from the Bronx moved to the rotation in August. He answered the challenge and finished the season at 5-2 as a starter. There are no tricks with Doherty. It's good, old-fashioned hardball. Throw the ball over the plate and don't give them anything for free. When it comes to walks, John's an old-fashioned Scrooge. At just 25, John can play the miser for a long time to come. Some other young arms got their chance to show their stuff. There were some rocky times, but there also was promise for the future. David Haas didn't get the call until August. When he answered the call, he made sure everyone heard it. Slipped into the starting rotation on August the 9th, David responded with 5 wins and 11 starts. The September start at Chicago was something special. David didn't walk a batter and neatly scattered 4 hits in an 8-0 shutout over the hard-hitting White Sox. John Kiley and Kurt Knudsen did not start the season with the Tigers. Mid-season promotions gave them their chance to shine. Kiley was recalled in mid-June and wasted little time. He finished the season with the lowest ERA on the staff. Knudsen got the call in mid-May. The right-hander spent the season in the bullpen and showed flashes of power. Usually, every season provides at least one pleasant surprise. This year's winner has to be Mike Munoz. Some gave the lefty little chance in spring training, but he pitched his way onto the team. And when the season was over, Munoz led the staff in games pitched. Appearing mostly in one-batter situations, Munoz pitched in 65 games and consistently got the job done. Other young Tigers made their first roars. Scott Livingstone was one of them. Scotty got his chance to play third when Fryman moved to short. He didn't blow the chance. For Tigers, batting at least 350 times, Scotty led the team at 282.
Here's a long drive. Way back in right field, and this one is gone.
First home run of the year for Scott.
Three run homer.
Late in the season, Scotty went homer happy. He popped four in 2 weeks. He guards the corner like a watchdog, and his arm has quite a bite.
Here's a deep fly ball to left. This one, if it stays.
Phil Clark got his first taste of the big leagues. The youngster played in only 23 games, but he finished the season at 407. He notched his first big league homer at Minnesota. Rich Rowland got a September call-up. He didn't play much, but the young catcher shows promise after pounding 25 homers at AAA Toledo. Pitching, of course, handcuffed the Tigers, but there were times when everyone did his part. Bill Gullickson and Frank Tanana were the Bluebeards of the starting staff. For the second straight season, Gullickson led the staff in wins and innings pitched. There's nothing fancy about Gullickson. He takes the ball and throws it over the plate. You have to hit Bill to beat him. There are no free rides. In 222 innings, Bill allowed just 50 walks. In his eighth year with the Tigers, Tanana again played Mandrake, mixing know-how with his teasing breakers. Tanana finessed his way to 13 wins, 233 for his career. Walt Terrell is a manager's dream. He takes the ball when it's given to him. He doesn't complain in between. Walt took turns between starting and the bullpen. Like that old favorite sweater, Walt was always around. Mark Leiter also traded spots between the bullpen and the rotation. He notched a complete game victory over the upstart Orioles. Of all the veteran pitchers, Mike Hinneman was there when he was needed most. In tight situations, Michael got the call. With 24 saves, Michael became the first Tiger ever to record four straight 20-save seasons. That pushed him to third on the all-time Tiger list. Michael's not about to stop until he gets to the top. And speaking of veterans, this one doesn't top any leader list. With his hustle and desire, though, Dave Bergman is a leader of his own. The veteran stayed ready for any emergency. His professional poise rubs off on the kids. One Tiger is special to all fans. If you don't like Skeeter Barnes, you don't like baseball. It was Skeeter's first full season on a major league team, and all it took was 14 years in professional ball. Infield, outfield, pinch runner, or pinch hitter. At 35 years old, Skeeter gets the job done. Never a complaint, never an excuse. Skeeter did whatever he was told. Congratulations, Skeeter, and thanks for playing so hard. Injuries play a part of every big league season. The Tigers certainly took their share of hits. No other injury crippled the Tigers like the one that struck Alan Trammell. Running out a ground ball on the night of May 15th, Trammell broke his ankle, and he never did return. Fryman filled his hole at short, but can anyone fill the presence of Alan Trammell? That special magic of Alan Trammell and Lou Whitaker, without warning, suddenly stopped. History touched the Tigers in 1992. A slice of it belonged to Lou Whitaker. On June the 6th at Yankee Stadium, with Scott Kamenicki on the mound, Lou collected the 2,000th hit of his Major League career. On July the 3rd at Tiger Stadium, Lou rocked Seattle's Jeff Nelson for the 200th homer of his career. These are storybook numbers for Lou and the Tigers. In the history of the game, Joe Morgan and Lou Whitaker are the only second basemen to collect 2,000 hits, belt 200 homers, and pile up 2,000 games at that crucial position. For this very special feat, and for all those sweet moves over the last 15 years, we thank you, Lou, and thank you, Alan, too. When it comes to history, it's tough to top the old man. This is a man destined for Cooperstown. He added some notches to his belt in 1992 that will make the trip a little smoother. On September the 27th at a sunny Tiger Stadium, the Tigers hammered the Indians 13-3. The race already had been settled, but it was a very special win. It was victory number 1132 for Sparky Anderson as manager of the Detroit Tigers. It pushed him past Huey Jennings as the winningest manager in Detroit Tiger history. Sparky also holds the Cincinnati club record of 863. Heading into the 1993 season, Sparky is just 4 wins shy of becoming only the 7th manager in history to rack up 2,000 wins. Those are some very special numbers for a very special franchise. But then, Sparky is a very special man. 1992 goes into the book as a season full of runs for the Tigers and a stepping stone for the future. With the dedicated effort of Sparky, general manager Jerry Walker, his assistant Gary Vito, and the entire organization, the Tigers are putting together a team that will roll up plenty of victories for many years to come. It's going to be exciting at the corner of Michigan and Trumbull. Mike Ilitch won't have it any other way. Just a taste of surprises to come, develop late in the season with the debut of Dog Row and the 7th inning celebrity sing-along. These were just teasers of much more fun to come. With Mike Ilitch, the fans are number one.
I'm excited. I want to get the fans excited. I want my team excited. I want the city excited. And I know before that can happen, we've got to make things happen. And I'm going to do everything in my power to make things happen.
Thanks to Sparky, the players, and especially to Mike Ilitch, for Tiger fans everywhere, the best is yet to come.